to fade
kill
rather than I've cleared out my calculation, which is I've just stretched all out and one can deal not down there.
I'll start with the items that happen.
Arcana check to find out more about this.
That's nothing I'm proficient with.
A six!
You have no idea what this weave structure should be, or well, most of the drawings look nice, but they don't make much sense to you. From the information that you've gathered from this, it looks like this thing is not very dangerous.
Okay. Doesn't seem dangerous, so if somebody wants a weird field that possibly is magic.
Do you still have the explanation of what the shield looks like in your head?
I think so. Some elvish, right?
Yes.
Elvish with basically looks like a piece of wooden root thingy on a shield, if I'm remembering right.
Yes. Would be numerous vines can be seen all over the surface of this very light shield, featuring a prominent picture of an oak tree in the middle of a gold woven center. Although it is a beautiful object of art, It looks worn, as if it had seen several battles. It seems to be made mostly of a crystalline material, except for some of the golden parts. So, from an artisan's point of view, this would be a very interesting object. Yeah, and okay. That is what you see.
Guys, if you don't mind, I would try out a shield. I wouldn't mind a shield, to be honest.
Well, I mean, it looks very druidish.
Okay, I walk to it and pick it up.
As you touch the shield, you suddenly feel a sting in your hand. That almost immediately faints after you get a grip on the hold. Or hold on the grip, sorry.
Okay, that was weird.
What happened?
Well, just felt a weird sting from the shield. But it went away instantly, so... I hope you're right that it is actually dangerous.
Hey, if everybody that touches it gets hurt, that would make it a really good shield, to some way.
Not actually.
Yeah, there's also some other interesting stuff in this book. I'd wanna have a hold a lookout for, well, some kind of staff, boots, and whatever the hell Fireguard is. Can I actually read in there what that would be, so we know what we have to look for?
Hmm. As you read the entry for Fireguard, there are some drawings of... it looks almost like an longsword or something like this. You can also see some copies of apparently artisans other interesting drawings that depict people in motion as if fighting.
Could be a longsword of some kind.
One second.
Either way, sounds expensive. And fiery.
Pardon me?
And fiery, I said.
Yeah. The text to this item would be, you read that also in the handwriting, this blade has cost me a small fortune, but after finding out how to form the weave permanently, I will be able to complete the rituals to recreate the effect. Unfortunately, one of the local lords has requested my attendance as his court mage. This will only further my goals, yes, but it will delay the next phase of my plan immensely. Once I am done with him, I shall continue my experiments. Who needs an army when you have the gold to buy whatever you want?
I'm starting to believe the old guy is not quite as friendly as we thought.
You thought he's friendly?
And there's supposed to be some gold. He has all the gold he needed. There should be some gold here.
And I look strangely at the edge of the room and look back at our monk. Like wanting to say, you mean that stuff? But not saying anything, just looking.
Guessing actually getting that all that gold out of here might be the most tricky part. Anyway, I think there's probably going to be more zombies ahead. I guess we could take a short rest here before looking for this very expensive sword.
I don't mind, but I really want to see that sword.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Just imagine cutting off heads and they don't say stop bleeding afterwards. I would so love that.
Which would make all those rope things less messy, right?
Beautiful.
Quickly out of character, did we already adjust our HP for the rest or anything? Don't remember.
No. At least I didn't. I did it now, once we started the session. I
rolled you a hit what?
Die. I rolled a hit die earlier.
Yeah, I used up one last session?
Yeah, last session in the upper room we did a short rest, I think, and down here when we came we didn't actually do the rolls yet.
Yes, yep. Exactly.
Down to one hit die.
Ah, right, yeah, we did that. Okay, then I'll also take a rest then.
Ah, actually, why not? Yeah, I'll take a hit die as well.
Boom, 6, and that brings me almost to full again.
Okay. So, as you take the rest, Roga wants to look further at the shield.
Yeah. Okay, I'll investigate the shield.
Let's go to the productivity lane for a second.
Okay.
User left your channel.
But good that Alex mentioned that we might have a level up even. Currently looking at the feats I might want to get.
I already know what I want to get.
I'm currently trying to decide between Linguist, Keen Mind and...
No.
Servant.
3 points of damage reduction against every physical attack.
Are we getting feats or are we getting points?
You can choose actually.
I go for a feat instead of points.
Whenever you can get an ability score improvement, you can also choose a feat instead.
Huh.
Yeah, now I've already picked what feat I'm in need of.
The thing is, most feats actually give you one attribute as well.
Yes.
Just if you take the attribute, that bonus,
okay,
you get
quickly.
Two.
Which side is the feats side? Which page?
That's...
It stands on the
165. 165.
Well, you'll need to note it after the session. As we won't level up while we are in session, I assume.
Probably not, yeah.
But
so that means we don't have anything to do right now.
Didn't we level up last time?
We session. Have no next level. We're on level 3 right now. Beats and stuff, level 4. We need at least 500 to 600 more experience points.
Which should be doable though, in this round, I guess.
Good work. Fact is, I've already read through all of them, and the damage reduction is actually kinda insane.
What is that actually where?
It's special heavy armor combat training thingy.
Ah.
Only works while you wear
heavy armor master, I guess.
Yes.
Ooh, yeah. Well, okay, only physical. Well, yeah, non-magical damage. Non-magical weapons, yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Which will count for pretty much every attack we are
currently encountering, yeah. And yes. Plus one strength is also probably not a bad idea. I guess you're not at 20 yet, right?
No, son, I'm at 18.
Yeah, the thing is, that's why I want to go for either Observant, Keen Mind, or Linguist, because that way I get my... I also get my intelligence bonus. I get a plus one there. Currently on 15 intelligence. And Linguist and Observant is quite a nice combination. Linguist gives you 3 additional languages. Observant makes it so when you see a creature's mouth while it's speaking a language you can't understand, you can interpret what it's saying by reading its lips. Probably gonna go for that one though. Sadly, not a lot that gives you a bonus to charisma. I think that's actually really only the actor thing.
Not sure about that part. I've only read for Archer Fane stuff.
Yeah. You don't want charisma to be increased. Isn't that like your main thing?
Kinda. It would be good for his intimidation stuff, but...
True. That is true.
I've got my hilarious ways to do that.
User joined your channel.
Okay. You guys finish your short rest?
Yup.
Anything else you want to do?
There's also some books over here, I think. Also like to skim through those.
Okay, you skip through the books. Most of them describe arcane effects that you have not encountered so far. And there are several rituals described in some of these books as well. With the magic gone in the form as it was before, you are not certain how useful these books will now be, but well, you can assume that for a collector they would be interesting. If you do not want to spend your time with them, which could provide you with additional informations, or could not.
Well, I wouldn't read them right now, but I guess if they don't weigh too much, I would put them in the backpack.
Yep, sure. So you have these books with you now.
Sure. Just write this down under books from the Sorcerer Tower.
Mm-hmm.
Wizard Tower.
One thing I wanted to ask, as I just remembered. Do we need to keep in mind what kind of gems we found?
I did write that down.
Yes.
Because I have slight problems with the speed, you always go through the gems and assume someone else is writing them down. I just write down 10 gems, for example.
Ah, okay, yep. Yeah, I wrote them down actually. All of them.
Yeah, if you need the information, I can give them to you as well.
How many gems do we currently have? Just to cross check that's correct.
That I do not have in one of the.
I meant Shufane, since you wrote it down.
Yeah, well, I've written everything down apart from what gems exactly there are. And I wanted to know how important it is for us in the end.
I'm at 24 gems currently, so if that's still correct, then I have all of them. By type. I'll
tell you in a second.
Otherwise, it could be that I didn't write down the last ones, but.
Oh, 24 is not enough. Got more.
Okay, then I probably didn't write down the last ones. Damn it.
The last time we got 11. No. 13.
Huh? Well, in total, I come up 27 gems. But, well, not important for right now.
Okay.
Just was wondering if it even matters for us.
Mm-hmm.
But now I was calculating one gem, approximately 10 gold pieces, and gem is gem.
No, you will find use for them. Future.
In then I guess future, we can just sell content. 3 gems, and then we're left with the ones that I wrote down. But yeah, okay. I guess we have time for that another time.
Yep, there is still an part of this basement that you have not visited so far. What would you guys like to do?
Will we keep on checking this room, or will we continue?
Yes, we can continue.
Alright, go ahead. Marching order. As this way is very narrow.
Do we hear anything?
Make a perception check.
Oh god.
Funny, I also rolled a 6, but it wasn't a fumble.
Perception it is.
Yes.
Found it.
I don't think I ever rolled a solo perception.
14,
you know
okay.
What? I just leave advantage in it and always tell you it's that left number if it's not. Because I always forget to turn it off.
Same here.
Okay, so we have 2 times 6, 1 times 14 and 1 times 23. Okay. The way you're currently standing, the 23 does not hear anything special. The 6s can not pick up anything that would be remarkable, and for the 14, do hear very silent noises along the corridor. But it's more like there is something, but it's, well, somehow dampened so that you cannot really say what it would be.
You guys hear anything?
Guess not.
Hmm? You do see that there is a corridor.
Hear anything, I said. That's...
No, you hear nothing. The yeah. Sixes do not hear anything that would be interesting.
Yeah. I asked the group, actually. That's...
Okay. Sorry.
No problem, just was confusing here for a second. Okay, I guess we go on?
Of course!
Then, Mr. Big Fellow, I guess you will go first, since this seems to be a bit narrow.
Okay, as always, why not?
Okay, second one to go?
That would be probably me.
Okay, third one to go?
I can always just duck behind the wizard, behind the druid, but yeah, I'll go third.
Okay.
Apparently I'm going last, okay.
Okay, you can move along the corridor.
I already started walking.
Maybe yeah. I always will leave a place for the monk there.
Over there, I would need a reflex save from Jafane.
Dexterity it is, and Dexterity tells me 9.
Oh, that is the sad part about always having advantage on.
I don't care.
You see it's the beautiful 9. Rolls you missed.
I can live with that.
Okay, this time you step on something and you lose your balance, fall to the ground. You are now covered in some kind of goo. This looks like more of the blackish liquid that came from the undead. It stinks terribly. And I would need you to make a constitution saving throw, please.
And that would be... Okay, something is wrong right now.
Just disable advantage or disadvantage.
I get the feeling it's broken. Anyway, that would be a 9 again, which makes no sense, but anyway.
Okay, as you step, as you smell this terrible, terrible stink right in front of your face, you have to hold to yourself to not throw the bit of things that you ate during your rests up again immediately. You are now considered, 1 second, I'll need to find the right name for this. Da-da-da-da-da, conditions. There it is. You are considered you are considered poisoned for as long as you have this goo on you, giving you a disadvantage on attack rolls and ability checks.
Okay.
You're fairly certain that getting this goo off your clothing and stuff would help you a great deal there.
I want to ask, can I get rid of that shit?
Yeah. If you get the stuff off your clothing and armor.
That would be how?
It would take you about 10 minutes. Of cleaning, because there's goo almost everywhere.
Yeah, the end of that thingy, is that just a closed door, or...?
That is a closed door, yes.
Guys, I might need a moment to get that shit away.
Wanna go back?
Yeah, I guess that makes sense. Everybody go back! Thank God, made a mess.
Well, you could assist him.
I guess you could use the carpet here to. Is that carpet valuable?
Would you take the carpet with you?
I don't know. If it's valuable, I probably would.
Well, you would probably find someone to sell it to. However, this would give you a disadvantage on several things if you take it with you right now.
Obviously not. I just was contemplating to use the carpet to get the goo off Trefane. And I wouldn't do that if it's valuable.
Make an investigation check.
Trefane already stepped on the carpet.
Alright, make an investigation check on to see.
20.
Well, it's a strange carpet, but actually you see some strange etchings on this thing. Now that you look closer on it.
Can I find it? What do you mean with etchings? I mean,
it looks like there's something.
Just craftsmanship, or does it look?
What you would have said before is reliefs on the sides. You would now say, upon closer inspection, what are the languages that you speak?
I speak Dwarven.
You would say these are Dwarvish runes.
There are some Dwarvish runes on this carpet.
Okay, once he says that, I actually look closer to the carpet as well.
And I walk away because I expect them to explode.
Alright. Everyone, go ahead and make a dexterity saving throw.
Go fuck yourself.
I already walked away.
Oh, come on, I don't want to play today anymore.
I already walked away, do it.
We'll get a plus.
Nope, you don't need to do it.
I have a 19.
Except for Roger, everyone manages to hit the safe DC of 5. Your shoe stepped in the goo that Trefane got off. And it smells awfully.
Okay, I start cleaning that.
Right. Yes?
While Trefane is cleaning himself, I will quickly check the book again if there's anything about the magical carpet or something like that.
Go ahead and make an... what would that be? And make another... Do you have proficiency in Arcana?
No.
Then you have no idea.
Damn it. That's why you should write down such scientific books should always be written so somebody who doesn't know the specifics understands it.
But the Dwarvish runes around it, except for one part that is covered in goo, they... from the lowest hive to the highest bring me forth.
I'm gonna assume. Okay. What was the last thing?
Bring me forth. The rest is covered in goo.
Is there any kind of, I don't know, dwarven lore about that thing?
How proficient are you in Dwarven lore?
I am asking, actually, the dwarf that.
And the dwarf is trying to remember. What did you say? Bring me the goo?
Nope.
Bring me forth from the lowest... I'm gonna assume mountain?
From the lowest hive to the highest...
That's the way, yes.
Oh, I guess to the highest mountain in that case?
Bring me forth.
Yeah, don't recall that.
But there is a big piece of it covered in this goo, so... there is something probably written under it. This is all you can read.
You probably have nothing to clean that. Try to remove that goo from a carpet, I'm guessing.
What if we're not carrying my Ajax spell with me?
I mean, depending on how the carpet is woven, I guess I could theoretically cut off a little bit of the sex with the gold, you know. one of the top parts that are not necessary and try to remove the goo with that.
While he does that, I walk back to the hallway and listen in just in case something happened. Yeah, I'm not playing today anymore, fuck this.
So, yeah, you hear,
nothing.
No. Yeah, nothing. Ulda is cutting something out of this, carpet?
No, I was wondering whether... I mean, I don't know the consistency of the goo, obviously. I was wondering whether I could take a piece of cloth, for example, from one of the gold sacks.
Okay.
And clean the carpet. So it would be.
One fast question. Because while Jafane is cleaning himself, he does a little experiment with a bit of that goo he takes off of himself and tries to ignite it. Does something happen?
Go ahead and make another constitution saving throw.
It's just a little bit.
Go ahead and make another constitution saving throw, please.
Just gasify that poison.
Oh, come on.
The smell intensifies again, and you grasp because this, although it was only a very tiny bit, it stinks horribly. Really horribly. You have just finished cleaning your armor and stuff. But you would need another 2 minutes to grasp a breath because that was just horrible. Horrible, horrible.
If I smell that from somewhere, I would say something along the lines of, "It's a wonder you're not burning your own farts."
That's none of a problem because they do that by themselves.
Anyhow.
Another piece of trivia I did not want to know.
Uldar, did you manage to clean the carpet?
I don't know. Magic voice out of the off, tell me.
The goo is sunken in. You would need something better than a piece of cloth to clean this.
Damn it. No, can't get any off. Oh well. We just had our stupid sorcerer still with us, who could read the book and see if he finds anything about that carpet.
Yeah, wanna then continue down the
dungeon? Yeah, I guess. Shafane is done with all this. Yeah. Want me to walk in front to check for traps?
I've already triggered one. I'm quite confident of triggering more, so I don't mind being in front.
No, that's the spirit. So,
as long as it's not me. So same marching order as previously, I guess.
Seems so.
Okay, let's go.
Okay. This time you know where the stuff is, and you manage to avoid it.
Am I clean of the negative effects stuff from that?
Yes.
No? Ah, good.
That took you a total of about 15 minutes now, but you are clean of this.
Good. So this time I walk to the door, not triggering any shit behind me. So...
I hold back a bit.
I first carefully listen on the door.
Go ahead and make a perception check, please.
16.
You hear something behind this door. You hear again the sounds that you have previously learned to connect with zombies. And in the background, you can actually hear some kind of sermon, some kind of singing, but very, very silent.
Okay. Sword and whisper to the other guys. Yeah, more zombies. Make yourself ready.
Want me to check the door for traps?
Just make yourself ready.
Okay. And I draw one dagger and my short sword.
quarterstaff in hand always.
And with Jophane's full smartness, oh. I kick in the door.
He didn't knock this time.
Hmm? That's character progression. Go ahead and give me a strength check, please.
21!
The curse is temporarily broken.
For a useless roll.
Depends, maybe he hits the zombie.
As you get a bit of a step back, because you know that you will need a lot of force to break this, you get the swing and BAM! Foot against the door. For a moment you feel that it could be not enough, but then you realize, wait a second, I'm Jophane, I kick in things all the time. The door gives in, and from behind it you cannot hear as something is hit by the door that you just kicked in. The angles are sprung, and this appears in front of you.
Disappears?
In front of you, beyond the door, is lying one of the zombies. You can see three other zombies standing around there, watching you, motionless. And, generally not doing anything. In front you can see someone who looks very similar to the more intelligent undead that you encountered on the upper level. Who has his back turned on you and seems to recite something from a book that he holds in his hands. What do you want to do?
So the zombies are not moving or doing anything, right?
They are looking at you.
And he is reciting shit I can't understand.
Which languages do you speak?
Common and...
Primordial? Yeah, Primordial. Give yourself Infernal from the background as an additional language, because with your character background you know this language. Three bonus language, yay.
Lovely.
You can understand that he is reciting something in Infernal, not taking the attention from the book that he is holding in his hands. And you guys can roll for initiative.
I was hoping that after I understand it, but I understand at least a bit of it, I can do one action against him.
Okay. Let's get the initiative out of the system and then you can take your action.
I have an insane number of 6 initiative.
I have more than twice of that. Which still is pretty shitty, really.
So, initiatives. 22 something.
No.
15 to 10.
Yeah, 15 to 10 we have.
Okay, how many times? And who?
Yeah, sorry. 13. Sorry.
Nobody 11.
Okay. 1 second. Ulda 13. Roga 11. Who is the next one?
Mo 8.
Mo 8. And 6 with Jophane, right?
Yes.
Okay. And...
That's amazing, considering Jophane is in the front.
That does not change anything else. Jophane, you hear this guy reciting something. At first, it sounds like gibberish, because it isn't an accent that you have not heard before. But then suddenly you manage to find some parts that you have read before in a book that you held very dearly for some time. And these passages are used to summon devils.
I would expect that to be the case.
You can make an insight check.
Ugh. 13.
You hear a bit of frustration swinging with the voice of the sermon. Quite a bit, actually.
Like he plans it. Still, as I hear him reciting that shit and knowing that normally nothing good will come from it, and seeing that zombies ignore me pretty much, I'd actually like to charge that guy with
someone. Okay.
Should be in range, yes.
The thing is,
as
you charge towards him, go ahead and make your roll for it.
What you mean? But charge?
Yeah, one of the zombies tries to grapple you on the way.
Okay.
But he fails. Go ahead and go for the charge.
Charge to the truth, Samson.
Okay.
And not sure, can I even attack after a charge? But just simply ram him against the wall.
Go ahead and roll for an attack. We'll say that it works.
Okay, in that case, let's check what happens. Yeah, of course. Fuck you. It's a 10.
You swing the sword, and you are fairly certain that this attack wasn't made in a way that you would normally hit him. But in addition to you not hitting him, somehow your sword seems to get carried away by some force radiating from this guy. Does not stop the Zerman, however.
Well, that was it for me anyway.
Yeah. Brings us to regular initiative. He is next. You can see him closing the book, turning towards you, and says,
"You may have information that I need. I sense it."
Turns around fully, holding the book in front of him, and it's Ulda's turn.
I will quickly dive through the monk's feet, below the monk's feet, whatever.
Uh-huh.
And since I am a nimble dwarf, lightfoot dwarf, I can still go up to here about, which should enable me to strike the prone
zombie?
The prone zombie with my short sword.
Okay, go for your attack and explain to me when you changed into a dwarf.
Halfling.
Okay.
I didn't have the time to get an energy drink. Okay. Do I get advantage since it's lying on the ground, or how does it work?
Mm-hmm.
This case. 24 connects? I guess?
That connects, and you can see that the zombie is stopping to move.
Yeah, okay. I like how you said that before I even started rolling my sneak attack bonus.
Fun fact, he got a door into the face.
Yeah.
Door steal damage.
Oh, do say.
Ah, these two.
And I would yell to Shafane. I mean, I guess I saw that his sword got kind of deflected-ish by a force.
No, you did not. You stood behind Mo.
Yeah, but I'm small.
Yeah, but no.
Okay, fair enough. You look through his legs.
In this case, actually, I will use my bonus action to now run all the way back behind Mo again.
Dash
for the win.
Get some pictured. How you crawl between his legs, jump at the...
at the only prone one in the room, stab him once, and run away. That is how the halflings do.
And hide behind his legs again.
Rogar.
I actually will draw, wait until Mo's turn, since I think it doesn't make sense that I can move past him here.
I would actually make myself, I would press myself at the end of my movement against the upper wall, actually.
So, yeah, against you I can, past you I can move easily, but with Mo I will wait until the end of his turn.
Just to point it out, I will facilitate you.
Okay, this brings us to the zombies. They start moving towards Chafain, as he can suddenly hear a voice yelling, "Day!" And the zombies shuffle back to their places, looking at Chafain but not moving. The voice came from the person in front of you, the undead, with the book in his hand still glaring at you. Brings us to Mo.
Okay, I guess I'll move forth. Okay, inspecting the room, I'll jump across the undead, and attack the guy in front of me with the quarterstaff.
I like how the zombies are currently not even attacking, but we're killing them.
Does a 9 connect?
No. That connects. Go ahead and roll for damage.
Ah, right, they are flat-footed, right?
Kind of. There is no flat-footed.
No, they actually have shitty dexterity, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, they have so many game turn. Roll for your attack. Thank you.
Damage.
You managed to hit this zombie, he is still standing, however.
I'll use my bonus action to do another unarmed strike.
Okay.
So a 17 should connect.
Yes, this connects.
And I do 6 damage.
Okay. Zombie suffers another 6 points of damage. This brings us to Chafain.
Well, as the zombies seem to not come my way, and that guy is shouting strange things at me, I just make a bit space in case someone might try to help me, and then slash at that guy with Chafain's greatness.
Okay.
Does a 23 connect?
You see that the blade is on the best way to chop right into his body, but again, it is averted by some kind of force. You cannot really tell what this is. But it is the second time that your sword did not connect, although it... Well, it is the second time that your sword did not go through as you intended it to.
Okay. In that case, I wanna check some. Can I? Does it look like he? Did he by now just move on his? Just turn around, or did he already move a bit as well? So can I assume he can move away from the place, or is locked there?
Go ahead and make a wisdom check.
And it is a 6.
It's hard to tell. He did not move. That's what you know. But you do not percept anything that would that would make sense for him to be immovable there.
And these two things next to him are candles, or?
Yes, they are candles burning with a green light.
Oh well, let's test it out. I just move a bit away to the other zombie, looking him straight in the eyes, and wait for my next round.
Okay. This brings us to Roga.
I start moving closer to the room. You move very far? Here? As I see the room, just start approaching this zombie, but don't have enough. They can't really move the full way.
Okay.
Or actually, right, I could just. Right, I can drop my spear and produce a flame and throw it at this guy's head.
Go ahead and roll.
Then 8 damage.
That connects to the beast and you manage to burn some of the upper head parts away, dissolving into the aforementioned black liquid. Smells horribly, but not as bad as the stuff that was in the hallway.
That's it.
Okay, this brings us to the undead on the altar. Turning towards you guys and bellowing. No matter how many you kill, it will never end. And he opens the book and starts incantating something once again. This brings us to Ulda.
Okay, I... Wait. I move back into the room. Now that everybody else is in there as well. I throw my dagger at the guy over here. The one that looks burnt.
Go for your attack.
A 20 connects.
Yes.
7 damage.
This burns him badly. Not burns, but this hits him badly, and you see that your dagger is stuck in the chest.
And I go, come on, Mo, give this one the rest. And then let's move on to the big guy, and I give him advantage on his next attack against the zombie in front of him.
Okay. Brings us to Roga.
Actually decide I might be able to finish him with another flame, so I produce another flame.
That connects.
With 3 damage.
Again, you burn parts out of this creature's body, but it is still standing.
Okay. I probably can't pick up with the rest of my movement the spear up, right?
Can.
I can?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, then I just pick up the spear. Does that take the full movement or...?
No, that takes half your movement.
Okay, after that I just move a bit here to the side so it can't really attack Uldar, just to protect him. That's my turn.
Okay. It is the zombie's turn again. They start shuffling towards you guys, and again you hear the bellowing from, No, this time you do not hear the bellowing, actually. You see that the zombies come closer and attack against Roga. The zombie fails miserably. Mo isn't hit too, and Chafane manages to avoid the attack as well. This brings us to Mo.
I guess I'll take the advantaged quarter staff attack against the guy.
Okay.
(clears throat) 22 and 17.
Connects. Go ahead and roll for the damage.
Take damage.
And again, you can hit him right where it would hurt for a living person. For the undead, he still takes a lot of punishment there.
I'll use my bonus action to do a unarmed strike.
Okay, go ahead, roll for it. That connects.
And another 6 damage.
And the zombie collapses after you strike him right at the forehead, where where the head wobbles back, falls to the ground. Head still attached, but neck obviously broken by your fist. But this brings us to...
With the rest of my movement, I would like to move here.
Okay. This brings us to Jafane.
That stupid zombie tried to attack me. I don't like that. I attack him. Yeah, I do not attack him. I fumble.
You do attack into his direction. Go ahead and make a strength saving. Strength check, please. As you slash your sword into the ground.
That would be a 13.
And you are dragging it back. You almost fear that your sword would be stuck in the ground, but then you concentrate, you push back, and it is back in your hands where it belongs.
I know my luck with take opportunities, so I just circle a bit, looking even more angry, and that was it.
Okay. From the word, you can now hear the incantation coming to an sort of getting louder, ending in something that sounds for everyone else like "Kinshkatsharyaksai." Jafane understands by the power of the evil forces, you will strengthen me. And the zombie between Mo and Rogar collapses to the ground, as does the zombie right next to Jafane. You can see from their body spiraling black bounce towards this guy who is standing on this altar, and he closes the book.
Now you will listen to me.
No.
As that happens next round. Okay. This brings us to Ulda.
I will just move over here and grab my dagger from the chest of that undead.
Okay.
And then move a bit closer and say, "So come on, Jafane. Give him some hell, and give him a bonus action against if he wants to strike that guy." And I would ready my attack to throw my dagger as Jafane does so, kind of as supportive fire.
Alright.
I don't want to be the first one to attack that guy.
Well, why not?
This brings us to Rogar.
I quickly check him if I can see any metal on metal armor or anything. Anything that's really hard to take off on him.
Enough for that spell to work.
Okay, then I use heat metal.
Any check I have to make?
Constitution save. Then I get a disadvantage on attack.
You get a disadvantage on attack.
Yeah, that's how it's written here, but let me check that.
Does that sound...
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense, right?
You mean he gets one, right?
At least the way you explained it last time.
Yeah, you just shortened it quite weirdly here on the spell list. Just a second.
That is auto-generated, but you do have an illegal copy of the player's handbook where every spell is in, just saying.
Control F doesn't really work that well there, though.
Yeah.
We pointed out.
Okay, yeah. It's like this, it has disadvantage unless it succeeds a constitution saving throw or takes the thingy off. So whatever I'm hitting. So right okay. Now, he doesn't have to do anything, I just do 8 fire damage. Just a second.
Ah, stupid me, basic rule, it's not illegal. Sorry.
Here you go. So yeah, I did that. 12 damage.
Yeah, it isn't the basic rules. I mistook that. Sorry. My mistake. You see that the heat seems to get absorbed by the field surrounding that being. How many times does this damage apply?
It lasts for 1 minute, so that would imply 10 rounds.
Okay. Very good.
Holy shit, okay. Yeah, that's my turn then.
Alright. This brings us to... Mo!
Yeah. I'll move towards him and... do a grapple move.
Okay. As you reach out to him, you realize that you cannot penetrate the arm, this aura around him with your hands. So the grapple is lost, as is the action that you needed to make this.
And I guess I'll use my bonus action to do a defense key move.
Okay. You mean the dodge thing as bonus action?
Yeah, patient defense. Spend one key point to take the dodge action as a bonus action.
Okay, for up until your next turn, he has disadvantage on attacks against you. And... you have advantage on dexterity saving throws. This brings us to Chafane.
That guy is getting on my nerves. And I walk to him. And let's check if I can slice into his stupid shield now. Ah, 22.
Again, you do not manage to penetrate that barrier, although you can feel it sort of getting weaker. At least you think that.
Port of fire? I critted.
Alright.
With my dagger throw.
Sneak attack damage?
Multiplication. Right, that applies actually. I completely forgot about that. In this case, 5 plus the 11 would be 16.
Don't you have to confirm that, Kurt? Or...
not anymore.
Okay, right, yeah, right, sorry.
Yeah. Okay. And, Chafane, want to do anything else?
Nah. I'm feeling good here.
Okay, this brings us to Ulda. No, not Ulda. He is first. You can see frustration building in the face of this being screaming towards you.
So be it. I offered you the chance to talk.
And you can almost feel an explosion going out from him. Go ahead and Mo, Jafane, from you I need an constitution saving throw.
18.
18.
Okay, both of you take 2 points of necrotic damage as a wave of pure undead evilness rolls over you. This lowers your maximum HP by 2 until you finish the next long rest. And you take the damage in addition. So your cap and your hit points lower by 2.
So we lose 4 in total or still just
2?
Okay.
Still just 2. Just the hit point maximum loses as well.
Yeah. Good.
And let me quickly calculate this. Alright. Good. Yeah, that is all that he does at this turn, actually. But you now can see that he is drawing something from his back. It is a greatsword, fiercely looking. And he prepares to go into full attack mode. This brings us to Uldar.
I should still have one more dagger.
Okay.
Since that has gone pretty lucky currently, I will step out of the druid's way in case he wants to do something fancy. Draw my dagger and throw it.
Okay.
Uh, 23.
That connects.
Uh, 15 damage.
Okay. You can see that the damage still see that your weapon still seems to have some problems piercing his defenses. But you hit him and you feel a gaze upon you from his side out of blue terrorizing eyes. I would need you to make a wisdom saving throw, please.
Ooh, Devin.
And you go mad.
You are suddenly feeling that angering this thing is a very, 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 very bad idea, and you take it that just 1 second, got to check this again. I forget the sides all the time. Nice. 90. You are considered frightened for the next 2 rounds, meaning that you have disadvantage on ability checks and attack rolls while the source of its fear, which is him, is in line of sight, and you cannot willingly move closer to it.
So much for my bonus action being another help action. I will, with the rest of my movement, hide behind the dwarf.
All right. This brings us...
Eight. I'm not even hiding well, for fuck's sake.
You still feel the gaze on you.
Must look like a little child looking up from the side of his mother.
You can't see me.
A little child hiding behind the fat, slightly older child.
Fuck you. Anyhow, yeah, that's your turn, right?
Yeah, this brings us to Rogar.
Quick question. With concentration, I'm not absolutely sure, but can I cast a spell that does not require concentration while I have a concentration spell up? From what I read from the rules, it should go. Just want to confirm by you.
I would say for this instance, yes, you can.
In that case... but I'll copy what I found about that, so you can read it later on. So,
yeah, or you could just go on.
Yes, I'm going. So, first off, as a bonus action, I cast I hit his thingy. So for 3 fire damage. Yay. And then I produce a flame. 18, does that connect?
18 connects, yes.
With a marvelous 3 damage. Fucking hell.
Okay.
My turn, yeah.
You see how the flames leak over this beast's armor and manage to hit it quite badly. In addition to the damage that he would take from the from your heat metal, how much would that be?
3 and 3, both of the sources gave 3.
Okay. That makes... Okay. Do you want to do anything else on your turn?
Can I make myself somehow, like, bigger so I hide Uldar better?
You could turn into...
You could help him with his next stealth check if you want to.
You could just breathe in.
Yes, I assist him with his next stealth check so he'll be better hidden behind me.
Alright.
That's my turn.
Yeah, this brings us to Mo.
Another quarterstaff attack.
Alright. Go ahead. Strike fiercely and true.
Pretty true, 23.
That connects. Go ahead and roll the damage.
8 damage.
Alright. Once again, you get the feeling that physical assaults on this being seem to be milled down by some degree. Would you like to spend your bonus action on more violence?
Yes, I would, thank you.
Go ahead.
I would like to use Flurry of Blows, which means 2 unarmed strikes.
Okay, the special things that you want to make with that are which, if they hit?
The first one would be so it can take reactions until the end of my next turn.
Okay.
And the second would be knocked prone.
Okay. Go ahead and roll your attacks.
Twenty-three.
That connects. Reactions are gone.
So the first one is 6 damage.
Hmm?
The second has 14. Does that connect?
He avoids this attack.
Okay, then he's at least unable to make reactions until my next turn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you want to move or do anything else?
No, this is it.
Okay. This brings us to Chafane.
Yeah. Chafane slices at him, and while I do so, I shout at Mo, come on, hit him again, granting him an attack if he uses his reaction. Also, I diced 18, does the 18 connect?
That connects.
Okay, so from me, first of all, 12 damage, and Maul can do one attack now as well.
A quarter staff attack.
Ooh!
So critical hit.
Alright.
He gets extra damage from me. Is that also two dice now?
Every dice is multiplied.
Oh.
Fucking hell!
I add 9.
Come on, Mo! Roll good, roll good.
Since I have 1d6, that means I have 2d6.
Yes, 2d6 plus your strength modifier. Dexterity, depending on which is higher. Or which you want to use.
What does the 9 do?
You add that.
That is bonus Chafain. Damage from Chafain.
He made you attack. He gets bonus solid.
You just roll your damage. Okay.
11.
That is total of 20. You see that these strikes. No, that's already doubled up. You see that these strikes hit hard, but the thing is looking towards. Oh, no, can't take reactions. Okay.
Yeah.
Chafain?
No. Oh, why not? I do my action search thingy so I can attack again.
Okay.
And I attack menacing. I hope it does hit. Lovely. Because I go for menacing attack. When you hit a creature with an attack, you can expend one superior die to attempt to frighten the target.
Okay, go ahead and roll.
It must make a wisdom saving throw or be frightened. And I add damage to my hit as well.
Okay.
So it takes a total of 17 damage. And a wisdom saving throw of 13, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
Or be frightened till the end of my next round.
Just by the way, its attack rolls and ability checks are on disadvantage. Because of me.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, yeah, right.
Just reminding you, Alex, just in case you forgot.
Mm-hmm. Nope, that's fine. He shifts his look towards Mo. Yeah. Okay. This brings us to creature. This time striking after Mo. The first is a 15.
Damage.
AC.
No. What's your AC?
Oh yeah, 15.
Okay. You managed to avoid this attack. Next is an attack that goes into the wild also. And it is beginning. You can see that parts of the flesh melt down from the burning armor as this beast screams in Infernal, something that only Chafain can understand.
You fools understand nothing!
And yeah, this brings us to Ulda.
Can somebody just gouge out those eyes that keep watching me, please, for fuck's sake? And I give the next guy to attack this guy with an advantage on their attack. And
the next guy is who?
As you will specify this.
I guess that the monk has the best ability to gouge out eyes, I think. But Chafain, it's more Chafain style, I'll give it to Chafain.
Yeah.
Chafain, gouge out its eyes, please! And since Rogar made himself big and rolling advantage on stuff. 22!
Okay.
Do I feel hidden?
You feel the gaze fading a bit. But you're not 100% certain if it's already done.
Shit. Now it's watching Rogar's damage.
This brings us to Rogar.
First off, I produce a flame and throw it at its head. 16, does that connect?
That does not connect.
Okay, the
avoids your flame.
Slightly missed that flame, but I still heat up its armor or whatever the fuck I'm hitting.
Hmm?
Or that would be 11 damage.
Okay.
And I again try to remain really awesomely positioned, so I help Uldar hide behind me. That's it for my turn.
You cannot give him an help action this time, as you just used your action to attack.
Okay.
Oh.
But you're just standing there. This brings us to Mo.
Yet another quarterstaff attack.
Go ahead. Resolve.
21.
Disconnects.
And 6 damage.
Mm-hmm. Again, slightly lower impact than you would have expected.
As a bonus action, I would like to just use one unarmed strike.
Alright.
Twenty-one connects.
Yes, that connects again.
For 6 damage.
Okay, another time you can manage to get your attack through. Would you like to do anything else?
No, this is it.
Okay. This brings us to Chafane.
Yeah, I've heard someone shouting, I should gouge out eyes. So I strike after that guy.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, before I can tell if I even do what I intend to do. No, I do not.
That strike goes somewhere, but I have no idea where this went.
It doesn't matter what I've planned, but no, it doesn't happen. I keep standing there, quite distracted of what the fuck just happened.
Okay, how long does the frightening work?
It's gone by now.
Okay. But in this case, the beast turns around again, looking at you and says, in infernal towards you,
I will not let this happen again!
And he strikes twice after you. Mm-hmm. First attack goes into nothingness. Second attack. Does a 17 connect to you?
Barely, yes. Well, as I remember at least.
Does it still have a disadvantage on its attacks, by the way?
Yes.
Okay.
That is calculated in.
Yeah, hits.
Okay. In that case, you take a total of 10 points of damage, and I would need from you a constitution saving throw. You feel some of the burnt and glibbering mass that is part of his body due to the flames that came out of the armor and make him melt internally. Get some drips of his blood and gore over your body, but where he just struck a big attack into, but you manage to avoid, to your knowledge, all bad effects from this. This brings us to Uldar.
If I'm not mistaken, the frightening should be...
is gone, yes.
Okay, then with my new braveness, I breathe in a few times and then rush out from my hiding spot, the furry hiding spot, and try to, hopefully while it still was not completely aware where I was, despite the fact that obviously it knew where I was, try to strike it with my short sword. Does a 21 connect?
That connects.
In this case, 17 damage.
Alright, that's another.
I'm back! Montefane, you didn't gouge out the eyes I wanted to give gouged out, and I give him advantage on his next attack.
Okay. This brings us to Roga.
Nobody will see, can see what I'm gonna do now. I begin with heating up his armor.
Mm-hmm.
For 9 damage.
Okay.
And then I produce a small flame in my hand and throw it at its head, which I miss.
Yes, you missed it.
And that would also be my entire turn. Thank you very much. See you next time.
Okay. This brings us to Mo.
Another quarterstaff attack.
Alright. Would you like to make a more fancy quarterstaff attack? Special moves? That hits the armor?
Now your quarterstaff is burning.
No, thank you.
No.
Not yet.
Heated metal, not burning metal.
Why not?
I aim for the flesh.
That sounds like a musical genre.
Would you like to bonus action?
Yes. I would like to make an unarmed strike against his face.
Go ahead and strike against faces.
Humble.
Go ahead and make a dexterity saving throw, please. Okay. You do narrowly avoid the face, and with a swift action you realize, oh damn, the armor's hot! And manage to pull your hand back before you actually get burned. That brings us to Jafaim.
Next awesome try to do my move. Please hit it. 15.
Does not connect.
Still no awesome is happening. But this time, as I do not need to hit him, to actually shout out this time to that little halfling being next to me.
Mm-hmm.
Stab him yourself.
That's just a regular attack, right?
Just a regular attack.
A 14?
Which is avoided by the speed. Anything else on your turn?
Nope, that's it.
Alright, this brings us to Witgen, who's still standing here and screams out, this time in common.
Why betrayed? Why did you betray? Why did you?
And it holds down the door, the walls of this almost empty room, and I would need a wisdom saving throw from all of you, please.
A 10.
14.
9.
Jafain and Uldar. You suddenly feel panic rising in your bodies as this beast apparently just went into full rage and revenge mode. Roga shakes it off without any problem, as does Mo, who is shaken for a short second but then remembers that balance and inner tranquility bring success in combat as in life. And this brings us to a frightened Ulda. For 2 rounds.
To be honest, my hiding is more of a intelligent thing, so I will just panic. When I'm panicked, I actually do more attacks than usual. At least that's what I've found. I guess disadvantage, or what would that be?
Yes, this is a disadvantage against him.
In this case, you'll just badly swing my sword. A 10 probably does not connect.
Yep. again trying to avoid the gaze of this creature, you do not connect your attack. This brings us, if you don't want to take a bonus action or anything like...
Kill it with fire, and with that I mean the fiery guy.
So, Chafane.
Yes.
Nice. This brings us to Rogar.
Admittedly, also kills with fire.
Or does he?
But way less efficiently.
I can't hear Rogar. Something is strange.
Neither can I.
Sorry, muted my mic because there were people talking outside my office loudly.
Okay.
So, can you guess what I'm gonna do?
Surprise me.
Miss with my produce flame?
Yes. How many rounds do you have the heat metal up now?
Shit, I'll go check, but it's still fine for now.
I think it should...
5 or something.
Yeah, yeah. Some... I'll
I
go
mean, he gets 10 rounds, right?
I'll go... 7 damage, that's my turn. Mm-hmm. Going... reading through the stuff now.
Okay. This brings us to Mo.
Yet another quarterstaff attack. With the flesh. It's a critical hit.
Yes!
Holy shit, man!
Go ahead and roll double.
Twelve damage.
Alright. Then you strike a fierce wound into this being. You can now see that it is already worn quite a bit from battle. And parts of the armor are finally falling off after the heating metal has dealt so much damage already.
And again, I would like to use an unarmed strike against him.
Okay.
Does a 21 connect?
That connects, yes.
For 6 damage.
Another strike. Another step taken to the goal of final destruction of this undead being. That brings us to Chafane.
Good. I first pull myself together, preparing my strike. As I say pull myself together, I basically trigger my second wind.
Does that resolve the frightening thing?
No, it only heals.
Okay.
But my stuff should cancel it out, so he should
yes.
have regular.
So I heal for a total of... 7,
isn't it? Yep. Nice.
And now, strike after him. Come on. Evil dice, do something. No, they do not.
They do exactly what I was planning. yeah, even with the fallen apart parts of the armor, that is still not enough to hit. But,
well,
it looked good.
I keep on looking evilly at him. And say, well, if you can't hit, I can't hit either, it seems. In Infernal, of course.
Okay. This brings us to the being looking you into the eyes and going,
you could have helped someone in need and you choose to leave me to this.
And, yeah. Strikes after you. First attack goes into nothingness. Second attack connects to you. For a total of 10 points of damage and... No, you withstood that, so no constitution saving throw. So you just take the 10 points of damage while he glares at you, still angry, still full of hatred apparently growing inside you. And this brings us to... Ulda.
Who still does not really care for anything, he just madly strikes at that thing. 12. I still have disadvantage, I guess, I'm still panicked.
Yes, is avoided by the beast once again.
And I shout just, come on, that dude is...
is dealing more damage to this, is injuring this guy better with a wooden stick and his fists. Pull yourself together. And give Shafane not disadvantage on the next attack. Whee!
Okay, Roga.
Yeah. It's not like our turns are any more diverse, to be honest.
10 misses, right?
Yes.
Dude, how at this point anymore? 4 damage.
I'll ask Shafane. I think he hit once in this entire fight.
Okay. Nah, I hit sometimes, but he had his shield at that time.
Ah, right, yeah.
That brings us to Mo.
Quarterstaff attack.
Come on, another crit.
That connects.
For 8 damage.
Mm-hmm.
And another one-arm strike. Does a 17 connect?
That connects, yes.
For 6 damage. And that's the end of my moves.
Mm-hmm. Brings us to Shafane.
Is that frightening till the end of my round or that zombie's round?
Yes, yours.
Yours, so, so Ulda, for example, is not frightened anymore.
Yes. This is your last round of being frightened.
Okay, well, anyway, I strike after that stupid thing. Something has to happen. Yeah, it does not. But yeah. I should be on my last. Yes. As I miss again, and it gets frustrating, I shout at Ulda, for once in a lifetime, take care of your enemies yourself.
I guess that means I can attack. Eight.
An exemplar of how not to do it taking place. The strike with the tip of the blade going through all defenses just to find itself dinking against one of those small iron plates on his studded leather armor.
Can we please call that zombie from now on a Jedi?
Well. Would you follow the ways of your monk? You would probably hit him.
I do not intend to run around naked.
Okay. This brings us to this undead creature again. Who strikes after one of the candles manages to connect and destroys this candle. You can see that the flame goes out and some part of him seems to give away. He then screams in Infernal, "The blades!" And not the blades, he screams the candles and strikes against the other one. Both of these candles go out and you can see that something is happening to his body. Brings us to Ulda.
I first try to stab him. An 11 probably does not connect.
An 11 does connect.
Woo! Like, okay, in this case, that would be 18 damage. Holy shit. Hmm?
And I go, if I could take care of them myself, I wouldn't be traveling with you guys. Come on, hit for once.
I like how we keep on taking a dialogue here.
And I like how, despite all that, the only one who actually deals a lot of damage
Rogar.
is 11!
Disconnects.
With what? It connects?
Yeah. Yes! I just connected with an 11 as well.
15 damage altogether.
10.
And that's my turn.
You can see as after this attack resolves, this thing goes into its knees, dating towards all that hear it. I commend my soul to liberty. Seems to be still sitting there, or better yet, to me there. This brings us to Mo.
I now have an advantage on attack, right?
You have advantage on your attacks against him. Yes.
Quarter step attack. Okay, 2 21s. I hit him for 6 damage.
You managed to again hit a deep wound into his body. Then you realize that somehow his body is regrowing from within, being replaced by parts of a blackish mass that seems to just springing to existence on every part that was burnt away, striked away. Brings us to Chafane.
Well, let's see if his head grows back as well. And with advantage, I've halved hit something. And a dice 20.
You hit him, you managed to get a deep cut into the upper torso. And you can also see that the parts where the head just over grow back, the tissue stiffens, and the head goes back into the upright position.
Ugh, ugly.
You can then. Do you want to do anything else on your turn?
By now, I fused up everything except for normal life attacks. I can't do anything else apart from running away, and Chafane never will run away.
Okay, in this case it is the creature's turn again. Stares you into the eyes, the only person from whom it has seen or heard that is Big Infernal. And you can hear from its lips coming,
I've tried so many times. You will not succeed. This is pointless. Take what you need and go.
And then he just stares blankly straight at the door. Brings us to Ulda.
Does it even seem to be fighting back anymore, in any way?
It's just kneeling there, staring into blankness and taking your strikes.
What did it say to you, Chafane? I would just ready my attack in case it attacks. In case it makes any hostile movement, I would attack. But otherwise, I would not do anything.
Okay. Brings us to Rogar.
I wait for Chafane's answer with my complete round.
Okay, this brings us to Mo.
I as well wait for the answer.
Okay, this brings us to Chafane, and I think we can drop the initiative.
Chafane first tries to cut off the head again.
Go ahead, roll for the attack. Again, you managed to strike, you have advantage. Go ahead and make the second attack.
Ah, oh. No. Ah, yes.
God.
Wait. Go for stupid, I actually realized it too. Another two more.
Okay. So that is 23.
I just want to be honest right now, guys. Considering what we did, we would all attack now after the Shafane would attack. I mean, let's be honest.
You can see as the head goes off, rolls over the floor. It stares at Shafane as it lands there. Yeah, you beheaded this thing. The body collapses together, falling into a sort of broken condition.
I know what you said was technically correct, but it did sound...
I broke him.
Like, it's a broken condition.
On the beast turns. On the beast's turn. Turns towards Bane with the bit of mobility his head still seems to have. You are surprised that it can move its head, although there are no muscles around. And looks at you and says,
"Just a setback
against an infernal, again an infernal.
It will happen again and again, time and time. You have achieved nothing."
Brings us to Ulda's turn.
Okay, this is taking a weird turn. I sheath my weapon and try to find my daggers, carefully in case the body may also still be able to move.
One of the daggers is broken, the other one you can retrieve.
Okay, so as we out on the initiative and so on, I say to Zavas, "Well, I knew I can cut that thing off."
Yeah, it didn't seem to have a lot of effect though. It talked to you after you cut it off.
Well, not that I'd mind.
Go ahead and make a perception check, everyone.
Ah, 16.
Mm-hmm.
No, 12 Uldar, 24 Ogar.
Everyone who did not fumble can see as the body of this thing liquefies on the altar, slowly dissolving into a... Oh, the head is still not liquefied. It's still lying there.
Woohoo!
You can see as this liquid apparently sensing gets long, thin, tries to grasp into every part of the room you can avoid narrowly. The tendrils of this blackish liquid. Mo is now gets aware of this as well. She was just doing something that, well, protected him from this.
Was he peeing at the corner or what?
Well, you can see as the tendrils try to grasp what remains of the head. Do you want to do anything?
Yes, I want to pick up the head before the tendrils get it.
As you touch the head, you feel that it has some liquid, well, not liquid, but wet condition to itself. So you touch it and it feels like you're grasping a piece of ice. The driplets of what by it ice would be flowing water. going down your hand, and you hear on the ground the from the driplets dropping there. See that the head loses its form and shape, rather quickly dissolving into a strange mass as well.
God damn. I was so hoping to take that head with me. And of course I say that in-game.
Now see that the driplets that fell from this head and the other tendrils of the blackish fluid that the body had become form into something once again, and within you can peek at something golden. Then a puddle of liquid forms, slowly moving towards the altar again.
I would turn off the candles.
Candles have been destroyed.
Ah, all of them. Okay, I thought some of them were still lit.
Nope. You can see, was on the top of the altar where formerly there was this body where the liquid has now gone, there is a pentagram drawn up on the ground. And apparently riled into the surface there. The blackish liquid fills it out after a while, forming this symbol. And poof, the candles go on again. Apart from the altar in the room, you can see several more or less interesting and good looking things piled up in a corner there, as well as books on the table right next to the door.
I'll start taking a closer look at the books, since all of this was very weird.
I checked that pile of stuff up in the left corner.
In this pile of stuff you find a pair of boots that are very light, apparently diaphanous.
Is what?
They are sort of transparent.
Ah.
In addition to this you can find a staff that seems to have an cobra's head on it. And you find a little... what languages do you have again? You do have Primordial, Common and Infernal, right?
Yes.
Okay. In that case you find a small bag there that has runes on it that you have not seen before. Also, still on the altar lays the sword that the fiend had in his hands.
Okay, so nothing of interest in that pile. That bag I put next to Ulda on the table, like saying, check it. And I, of course, go for the sword.
Okay. What do you do with the sword?
What kind of sword is it?
This seems to be a great sword. As you look at it, you can see that it is made out of a blackened metal, or the metal itself is black, you cannot tell. There are symbols and sigils of flame, and some symbols that you knew from your book on the surface. All of it is in reddish and orangish shades of color.
I pick it up.
I will need you to come with me into the other channel. Productivity lane.
Yeah. User left your channel.
Yeah, I think we should have probably talked to that thing. Retrospect.
I think that thing was trying to become a demon.
I think it might actually have been trying to die.
Well, can't say we didn't try helping it.
Yes, but that's exactly the thing. That's why I think it was so resignated at the end.
User joined your channel.
Oh, that was quick. Yes. You feigned dead?
No.
No, he is holding that sword in a sense.
And I do some... I do some test swings. If it's... like I'm used to.
You swing the weapon through the air and do you want to combine this with a short rest? Taking some time to... swing it around.
Well, so I was also keep on checking and resting here.
I mean, I'm going to read through the books to see if I can find anything on this ritual thing.
Mm-hmm. What is Mo doing?
Nothing.
That's very much. What is Roga doing?
Actually, check up on Shafane since he got hit in the fight, if he needs any help.
You can see him swing the weapon in the air. He seems to be busy right now.
In that case, I join Uldar and just look around the room.
You can inspect the bag that Shafane.
Okay, inspect that bag.
Didn't.
Okay, you recognize the runes. First off, for Shafane, as you swing the sword, you realize that it is similar to the weapon you had before. This, however, you suddenly become aware that you have not yet noticed most interesting detail that differs this from your sword, because this apparently is a flame sword. In German it would be a Flammschwert. Where
yeah,
the... yeah, I was assuming that you might know what this looks like, but I wanted to make sure.
Okay.
It is not flaming, however, it's just a form.
Just a form?
Yes.
Okay, as part of my testing, I of course use one of the dead zombies as a testing dummy, you could say.
Okay, as you swing it through the as you swing it through the air, you hear that the sounds of it are much louder than you are used to by a sword. It seems to violently cut through the air. And as you hit the zombie with it, you see that it does cut the flesh more lightly than in your previous encounters. I'll quickly... so that we are on the same page. That is something that you could look at to see what I am referring to with a flaming kind of look.
Ah, okay.
Ah, that thing. I had one of those in Diablo 2.
And, yeah. As you spend more time with this, you realize that this is a greatsword plus one. Plus one to your attack rolls and damage rolls.
So it is also counted as magic, some?
It is a magical sword, yes. And you heard the thing. For Roga, as he looks at this bag that's there, it is of dwarvish making. And you can see depicted on it several scenes from dwarvish mythology. Among them, the great fight against the stone giants, which was ages ago. Even you only know from myth, and no one really knew what happened in this time. But this is a tale that is told every now and then. Well, let me quickly check something there. You can make an Arcana check.
Not proficient.
You can make an arcana check.
Okay. 5. I said not proficient.
It is looking very neatly, and you feel a strange thing about it, but you cannot tell why or what it is. As for Ulda, the books that you check on this table seem to be less of ritual books. They are more like more like descriptions of other approaches of scientific research or magical scientific, arcana scientific research, arcane research, one could say as well. I don't know what the best word would be. You see that there is among the things a soul bind ritual that is described. This is pretty much the only ritual described in there. And on the same page where this ritual is described, you can see that someone has with blood or another red liquid, but you're fairly certain that this is blood. Traitor, numerous times, over and over again, all over this page. On the next side, you can see a list with, almost looks like a list of methods to kill yourself. All of them are, there is a line through them, as if someone had kept a list on how one could kill himself and crossed out every other thing there.
Weird. Hey, Shafane, you never actually told us what that thing was saying to you. Mind shedding a light on that?
Well, just something about repeating itself. I assume that thing will stand up in a matter of time again.
Yeah, because it seems like somebody's has been trying to kill himself, and I mean, that thing wasn't exactly fighting after some time.
It could be that it actually tried to die and can't die. Yes, it'll get resurrected. At least that's what it sounded like it wanted to tell me before.
Well, might have been interesting to actually talk to that thing. Not going to blame you, though. I think we've all had our share of undeads for this lifetime.
Well, if I understood it right, it'll stand up again. So you're free to come back if you want to.
I think it will be mad at us for trying to kill it. I mean, technically, we've been doing what it wanted us to do, just not the way it wanted us to do it, most likely. I'll probably be reading up on this ritual a little bit more. Soulbind.
Then go ahead and give me an arcana check.
I was mostly saying that, but yeah, sure. A5.
You try to get behind what the person who wrote this was trying to achieve there, but you do not manage to grasp the idea how this should work. However, there is a mentioning of two people over all the pages. And one of the sentences is interesting enough to catch your eye, as there is a crawled hand note that says a bound of blood may strengthen this.
What?
Bound of blood may strengthen this.
It's written in that book thingy.
Yeah, handwriting. The same as with the research. Not the same as with the traitor.
Wait, the traitor thing, we saw something about that upstairs as well, right?
Go ahead and make an intelligence check. Everyone who heard that question.
Eight.
16.
Everyone except for Ulda seems to remember that that other undead upstairs accused Rogar, the wizard, of betraying him and his brother.
Inform others about that?
Hmm?
Will you inform others about that, Rogar, or...?
I'll remember that, except for you.
Yeah.
Or do I have to do it? Never mind, yes.
So, I'm assuming this might be that guy, that other undead brother? Or boss, or... will be again, I don't know what the correct term is.
I guess they did look... similar.
Yeah.
Well, they looked more distinctive than all the other flesh things.
I just get slight feeling we should actually throw that old fart in here. Because... smells a bit suspicious.
But out of character, I actually thought we also saw something traitor written somewhere actually on the... upstairs in the tower where we found the dead guy that went with Halungalam.
There you could read he knows.
Ah, right, that was that. Just hope that Halungalam is not really involved in any of this. I mean, he was not exactly a sane or good or... actually, scratch it, I wouldn't really be surprised if he was in this.
More importantly, what do we do with about the old fart? I don't like Shafane's idea too much, but I can't see his point. I mean, God knows what happens if we bring all of this stuff back to him.
Well, he seems to be incapable of doing magic anymore. And I mean, I wouldn't bring anything back to him anymore.
Just
anything
so you know,
either.
I do not intend to hand anything over to him anyway.
Absolutely.
And... all this thing, I just want to mention, I trust him even less now. He always sounded suspicious, but now...
we could say that everything here has been robbed or something, or destroyed,
yeah.
I don't know, something like that.
Did we even say we bring him something?
No, he said that it... You know, he oftentimes mentioned that we would need a lot of money for his plan. You know, like the stuff that is written in there in this other book where he says he needs a lot of money before apparently betraying the king. Or planning to betray the king.
Okay, in that case, this does look like a lot of money to carry. How much would you guys guess it weighs? As in,
DM,
how the hell do
us,
we get...
please.
A lot. A lot.
Any ideas what to do with this?
I mean, you have a neat new bag.
Yes, that's what I also wanted to try out. But we'll roleplay it in a second. Next thing, do we want to take this money to...
not in its current form. I mean, can you imagine what will happen if we show up at that bandit camp with this amount of gold?
Exactly.
Screw us trying to help them. If we bring that much gold, they'll kill us for it.
On the other side, with this much gold, we could probably even buy off some of those... I mean, quite a few of those bandits.
That is true, but...
okay,
we could also do a lot of other things with that.
Yes, we would need a fair share of it once we reach the town.
Anyhow, while we're discussing this, I fool around with the bag, try to put some useless stuff into it.
Somebody better.
I would need you in the other chat.
Yep.
User left your channel. User left your channel.
And he has found an endless bag.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure about that as well.
Problem solved.
Or it doubles up everything that was in it.
That would be overpowered. Completely.
Well, thing is, Jafane would instantly try to crawl into it.
One thing, I'm guessing the staff might potentially be something for you, Mo. I mean, I'm guessing you found Flame Guard.
I'm gonna ask if we can check up on the...
We're still missing the boots, actually.
Oh, we actually got the boots.
Yes, they're still lying in the pile of stuff.
Hear it mentioned, actually, that there were boots in there, but okay.
I just ignored them, and you should check because they are flying boots for you.
The staff I heard, but okay, the boots, yeah. That's why I am actually very interested in those. That sounds fucking awesome. I'm guessing it's really just movement speed.
Actually, they prevent you from taking falling damage and stuff.
Oh,
yeah,
that
I think
fun.
You said falling damage.
You basically glide like a feather down.
Well, I mean, the monk can do that anyway.
Yeah, but
kind
we
of.
Can now throw you.
Not yet.
No?
Level 4.
But you can also only do it if you're close to a wall.
We can put you on a catapult, and you will land softly.
Sounds actually fun enough for Ilda to try it out, but...
Or of course, Jafane and Mo can throw you. And the only risk you take is of hitting something with your head while we throw you. But the landing will be softly. I like how you only told me that the sword is cursed and takes forever with you guys.
What was that, sorry?
I like how Alex only told me one sentence and was done, but you also could have written me on Skype.
User joined your channel.
Takes forever for you guys.
User joined your channel.
Hello.
Hello.
So, guys, I have a strong feeling this might be a bag of holding. Which means that
can hold things.
Roughly, from what I know about them, we can store a lot of stuff in it. I mean, a lot of stuff.
That sounds interesting.
Oh, Udar, will you give me a hand? And I open the bag next to useful stuff, so he can start throwing stuff in.
Just a second. Has anybody found the? I'm guessing, Jafane, that should probably be the Flame Guard.
It does surely look so.
And then there should still be some Staff of Aether or something like that. And some boots.
Yeah, that stuff is in the pile on the edge.
Okay.
Kind of seen it before. Just ignored it.
Well, let's check that out quickly. Yep. I'm guessing staffs might be your thing, your monk.
Yes, I am curious about the staff. Show me.
Okay. Ulda, as you might read from the book again about this item?
Yes, sure.
You read in the book, the guy who sold the stuff to me was stupid enough to miss the magical properties of this item. The weave is strong in this thing, but it is far beyond my understanding right now. Let's see when I will be capable of understanding this thing.
For the boots you find, the effect is interesting, but I am too far away from the basics to get the weave replicated like this. Should be a matter of years until I can replicate the effect though.
Well, I guess upon hearing that, I'll walk over to the staff and try to pick it up to look closer.
Okay. You take the staff of the adder, you can see at the top of it a snake's head ready to strike. But as you take it into your hand, you realize that this is of no use for you. It feels wrong to hold this thing. You don't get any feeling that this could be a worthwhile thing for you. It is far too heavy. It is. The head looks too fragile to actually hit with it, and
the GM is telling you, give it to the druid.
The GM is telling you it looks like it is not the best quarterstaff in the world.
I guess I'll try handing it over to Rogar and ask him what he thinks about it.
I happily try out the staff while I just hand over the bag of holding to Uldar for that time.
Go ahead and make a charisma check, saving throw.
Who?
Rogar first.
Six?
Wait, did you just roll twice?
No. Yeah, that was from before when I was in the bag of holding.
Come with me to the other channel again.
User left your channel.
Yay, loot, more loot for me!
User left your channel.
Really have to check how far we can open that bag of holding. I wanna try to put a wall table in it.
That would be funny.
Yes.
Can we put people inside there?
That's why I wanna try it. Maybe
we could probably hide a halfling in it.
Yeah, maybe we can use it as a makeshift tent. In the night we all crawl into that bag.
As in Harry Potter's tent?
Yes, exactly like that. Oh well, anyways. Once he comes back, you can tell him that I'm on a fast check for my laundry. We'll be back in 2-3 minutes, something like that.
Okay. Well, I guess the staff is not for me.
User joined your channel. User joined your channel.
Shafane is on his quick break.
Okay.
Okay, so
For the rest of you guys, because you already see this.
Oh, right. Sorry, I wanted to ask them. Did everybody else see that? Forgot they didn't hear.
Yep, they did. As Ulda was making some sounds, talking in a strange tongue, you see that at the end of the staff, this the snake head becomes alive, and I would need a reflex save from. Let's see who this could get.
It's me anyway.
It's most likely.
It is Mo.
Yeah.
Oh. Reflex would be dexterity.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Sorry, dexterity saving throw.
But congratulations, I think that's the first time you said it wrong this session.
Yeah.
24.
You avoid the attack by the snake. And you can see that the staff apparently has come to life in some way.
What the hell?
Yeah, I'm going evil, apparently.
Did that thing just strike at me? God damn.
This Rogar whistles another thing in his druid tongue. The snake becomes solid again.
Okay, at least you can control it, I guess.
Yeah, let's go with that. I point the staff away from everyone and everything that would be harmful and try to make it move again. With the same words as said earlier, to make it move.
Okay, say the words.
And Druid didn't say...
Ah, the Druid, not me.
It's a nice snake. But I have to say it on Druidic.
Yes, so sure. And suddenly the snake springs into living existence again and is. Can you write that down?
Ulafashach.
Ah, Ulafashach.
I can cheat since we have our. Sure.
Alright. As for the boots. Or the bag first.
Bag, yeah. I still have the bag. I didn't hand it over since I remembered I do not want Uldar's greediness to possibly take anything from the bag.
Uldar does not react to this. Just staring in silence.
What? That he doesn't want to give it? Oh, he actively doesn't want to give it to me. I thought he was actually the first one in the first place to.
No, I was first thinking to it, but then I remembered that I do not hang the bag over. Not at all.
So then there's really not a lot for me to react to be honest. And I would try to find those boots. Those also sound interesting.
Yeah, you find them between the stuff.
I'll read up on those. Maybe, true. Get an idea for what they do before I put them on. If they even have my size.
Yeah, you take some time to tune to them, and I would need you to come with me into productivity lane.
Whee!
User left your channel. User left your channel. User disconnected from your channel.
With what?
User joined your channel.
What happened? What, eh?
I pressed the X again.
Yeah, be right back.
User joined your channel.
Okay.
I think those boots... I'll take those boots. If you guys don't mind.
I don't.
Mind sharing why?
Well... It would make sneaking even more easy if I was able to fly, wasn't it?
Demonstrating that? Not that I don't trust you, I just wanna see
I'm just judging here from, you know, how light they are and from what's in the book and stuff. You know what, fuck this, I'll try it out. And I would then.
I mean, Fane's still polishing his sword, yeah. Not responding, so we have time.
You put on the boots. You have already taken quite some time to look into them. You have now got a feeling of how this could work. And how do you want to try to activate these things?
I have legitimately no idea. My first impulse would be to make swimming motions through the air. Then maybe jumping.
None of these seems to have quite an effect.
Oh, let me guess, I have to activate them with Druidic.
I climb on top of the table. Uh-huh. And I carefully try to not jump off, but instead just walk off.
You seem to fall a bit slower, but that seems not to do the trick. Maybe there is, I don't know, move that actively has the boots, or that is a command word or like.
I'm just going crazy.
Hey, didn't you see? I was way slower this by descent, at least. That I'll climb up again to demonstrate, and this time I'll actually jump in the air. I don't know high the ceiling is, but since I'm a halfling, that should probably be possible.
Yeah, you swift down just a little bit slower than usually. And you can see at the side, apparently the small wings on the side of the boots, which are transparent as well, seem to flutter a bit.
My staff activates with to me saying stuff. Maybe it's something similar for you.
Up, up, and away!
Do you want this to work?
I do. But Hawk has already suggested it, I have already thought of it, but I will not do a Dorothy and go, there's no home like home. No place like home.
Please, bind it to that, Alex. Please, 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 please.
Send me a link.
You know Dorothy from
The Wizard of Oz. You know, tapping the heels together and going, there's no place like home.
That sounds pretty good.
I have returned.
Welcome back.
They are Dorothy-izing my boots.
You did what?
You need to tap them three times and think to yourself, there's no place like home, and then say up, up, and away. There.
I think more fitting for Ulda would be, there's no place like gone.
Yeah, that looks good.
Hey.
Alright, you know how to activate them.
And then you can fly over it.
But you have to ask your halfling.
I'll actually demonstrate that. After, yeah, I think I have a feeling for how this works. I will just tap the heels and think to myself, there's no place like gone. And then try to again step off the table. Without touching the ground. That would be the idea there.
And the little wings on the side of the boots start fluttering maniacally as you manage to get just a tiny bit up in the air. It is a bit harder than you thought to stay upright, but you manage to keep your shit together, and after a few minutes you're quite good at flying with these things already.
Well, seems like I won't be using the ladders to get up on up again.
How fast can you rise?
About as fast as I can run, which isn't that fast, but you know. Out of character, wait again. You said 30 feet?
Only when descending.
Only when descending, ah, right.
Your flying speed is equal to your walking speed.
Okay. Because otherwise...
And for the rest, so you can see what... so you know as well what he just found. While you wear these boots, you have a flying speed equal to your walking speed. You can use the boots to fly for up to 4 hours, all at once, or in several shorter flights. Each one using a minimum of 1 minute from the duration. If you are flying up to 4 hours.
In total or per day?
In total, that comes soon. If you are flying when the duration expires, you descend at a rate of 30 feet per round until you land. The boots regain 2 hours of flying capability for every 12 hours they aren't in use.
Gosh.
But does that mean...
How is he flying above our heads all the time? Like a little fairy.
An hour. So, how does that work? They need to not be in use for 12 hours completely to recharge 2 hours, or is 6 hours enough for 1 hour, or...?
Nope.
So 12
2
hours.
Hours after 12 hours.
So 12 hours they mustn't be used even a second for them to recharge, okay.
Yes. I know, I'll use one of those circle thingies above my head to keep track of how many minutes I have left. So you said an hour I trained about, right?
Yep.
Circle thing is above his head?
You know when you click your token.
Ah, okay.
So I have 180 minutes remaining. Presumably, I mean... Oh no, right, I'm pretty sure it wasn't used in the last 12 hours. Probably not, since...
Well, it's not like you instantly die when they deactivate, so... Anyhow, did we already collect all the stuff from this room? Yep.
No, I mean, you have the...
Yeah, yeah, help me fill it up.
Did you already try to put the table into that bag thingy?
What? The bag is only 2 feet at the opening, so no.
Ah.
No.
But as long as we put something in with 2 feet diameter tops, it fits.
4 feet. And we need to be careful about the max weight. That's 500 pounds. If we go over that, we lose everything.
Okay.
It auto cleans itself.
It is destroyed if you overload it.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
We don't wanna overload it.
So much for my house in the bag plan.
How do you get the stuff out again, actually?
I can take everything out for one action. Well, whatever I want. Or if I remember correctly, I can just turn it around and everything spills out, right, Alex?
Yes.
Everything, yep. Or can he more or less like...
Or I can just take stuff
imagine
out, so...
one thing and that thing will drop out.
Then I can just pick it up or just put my hand in and find it.
Okay.
It takes one action to do that, so... To be honest, it's much faster than purses. How long will we need with purses, so I'm fine. Anyhow, back to this. Okay guys,
well,
wanna start going back? We can still pick up the gold now with this bag.
I was actually just... I'm now imagining, you know, like... I don't know. Going somewhere to buy like a property or something, like a big house of some kind or something. Just going there with this little bag and being like, will this be enough? I don't... And then just, you know, dropping it all out like... You sure about that?
Better idea. Because will this be enough and start putting the coin after coin out of the bag on the table? Table fills and fills and
could
fills.
You fill it with water?
Alex, can
yes?
we have an off session where those two try to make stupid jokes?
Yep.
Okay.
Perception check, everyone.
The undead is coming back, I guess.
24 for Rogar.
15.
8.
And Mo is asleep.
I'm not.
He just doesn't care if something happens around him.
He's peeing in the corner again.
He's gonna roll a 5 anyway.
I will just say that Chafain is standing there for some reason.
Hey.
Because otherwise I would have to ask you for an...
23.
Alright. Otherwise, I would have to ask you for a dexterity saving throw.
Again.
As suddenly, from the ceiling, you can see an stream of dark light falling. Not stream, and a ray of dark light falling onto the pentagram. And it is a ray. That's the only thing resembling light there. It is like there were rays of blackness falling into the mass, and out of it forms the undead that you have fought before. Again, he is standing there in his full montour with sword back on his back. And Jafane, you can see that the sword that you had just taken is gone from your hand. It is in his hand again. And
understand, Jafane is now planning to charge that guy just because he wants the sword.
He stares at you before you can move in any way and says,
"We can talk about the solution, or the circle will go on for eternity. It's your choice, mortal."
Sorry, does he say it in Infernal again?
Yes.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Basically, what Jafane also says. For fuck's sake, what's your problem? Tell me.
Can you not guess? I cannot leave. Neither can my brother. If you fail me again, the blade will hear. Even if you fail him again, he will rise up again. All I need is what you already have in your possession to end this curse.
What is he saying, Jafane?
I'm talking. And what would that be?
One of you has it with him. I feel it, though I not see it. It belonged to my brother. Only if we united, this can end.
And what's in for us?
What more would you ask for? The wizard cursed us. We would watch over his belongings. And we have been here for ages. You help us, you have never to fight us again. You take this sword with you. I don't care.
Tell you what, tell the full story. What's with that wizard guy? And we'll help you, I assume.
I cannot.
Go ahead and make a diplomacy check, please.
Nope, that's all infernal. Deception, or what's diplomacy now?
Diplomacy should be persuasion.
No. Six.
A slight chance. Finally finding rest. More than I have seen ages. I shall tell you the story. Though your allies, they stare at me in a strange way. I shall not start telling my story if they show any sign of assistance to me.
Of what?
Assistance. You want to instill hope in me and then just leave like all the others did. The
then we can just or this. I keep my blade and wait for someone worthy of taking it.
Okay, and I talk to the others. A moment. So just so I remember, did I take the magic copper coin with me, or was it one of the other guys?
I don't know, who of you took it?
Most likely was me, because I believe in the most magical copper coin of the
world. That case?
Sure. Let's assume it was that way. You fine with that guys?
Yes, I remember, yeah.
Good. I take out that magic copper coin. Look at him. Assume you want that thing.
This is it! It's my brother's.
It's just so near, so tell it and you get it. Deal?
Alright, I will tell. And you can see that the blue that filled his eyes before fades into a lighter blue. He now starts speaking in common. There once was a time when I was foolish enough to believe that I could master the schools of magic. The necromancy, they interested me and my brother. Having the power over life and death, it was all that we longed for. And then a man in robes came, an old man. He promised us to show his strength, show his power, make us his apprentices, his willing servants, if you may say so. I believed him every word. My brother was hesitant, but I convinced him. There was no other way. Being born in Prasna, to grow up a farmer. What life is this? So we came here. He told us he would need a blood oath. Make us his apprentices. Then the pain started. It rose. Our bodies are withering away. Forced us to become his watchdogs. Incapable of attacking him. Forced into service. Never to leave this tower again. Centuries have passed since then. And I would love to say that I have had my sweet revenge, but I have given up on this. All I want for me and my brother is to finally be able to sleep. We could just sleep. Now you know my story. You hand me that coin, or shall we repeat the cycle of death and killing, just to start where we began?
Well, sounds fair to me. And I flinch that copper coin, copper thingy to him.
He grasps it in its hand. He squeezes the hand so firm that you can see a black liquid flowing down his arm. He then stares you into the eyes, the color in them fading from the lightish blue that you've seen just moments before into a black. And then you can hear from upstairs a scream, inhuman. From him, you can see as he collapses to his knees and looks you in the eyes and again speaks in infernal. I shall ask one more favor from you.
I look at him and ask, and that would be?
Finish me with the very blade I was bound with. Takes out a greatsword, throwing it in front of the altar. Out of that field that you have encountered before.
Well, if you ask for it. And I approach him, pick up that sword and go for a beheading.
he sees your movement, he says, wait! Beheading will not work. You have to go through the heart. Puts the coin in his hand over the heart. You can see the black liquid still dripping on the floor.
Well, we can try that for once. And I stab him to his heart, where I assume his heart should have been.
You can see the blade as you thrust it towards his chest, going straight through the hand. You would have expected more resistance from the copper coin, but it melts through it as if that was nothing. You see how he changes the expression on his face from this suffering, from this strange, unnatural pain that he felt before, going into real pain. He screams out, and all you can hear from him is, finally, last pain, as he starts burning everything of his armor that he was wearing again. It was all full of good again, burns away. You can see as he loses his form, hear a faint infernal thank you as he burns to the ground. Sudden scream erupts from him, and the blade that you just had, that was black in its fullest, you can see that one of the symbols on it is now having that coppery color. See on it a small driplet of blood flowing down, falling to the ground. And with this, we end our session for today.
A short one.
Felt short, but it actually was. Yeah.
2 hours, 50 minutes.
Yeah. Hate to be that guy, but experience?
How many scrolls did we kill?